Hello everyone, this is me Rishabh. Welcome back again to my new podcast. So here I have brought a very, very interesting guest, Mr. Abhilash. So Mr. Abhilash is basically an author of a book, Mind Under Microscope. So let us talk to Mr. Abhilash, let us know about his book, and let us know everything about Mr. Abhilash's journey, and let us learn something from him. Hello Mr. Abhilash, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. What about you, Rishabh?
Yeah, I'm also doing great. So Mr. Abhilash, like, thank you so much for coming and like giving your precious time to me and to my audience.
Yeah, no problem. I'm also having a good time with you, talking about books and all. So
yeah, exactly. So Mr. Abhilash, like, can we start the things? Can you like generally introduce yourself, that what do you do and basically where are you from and everything about you?
Okay, sure. Basically, my name is Abhilash and I'm coming from Kerala. I've done my graduation in BTech Computer Science. After that, I pursued a career in banking as an officer. Then from there, I resigned after working for some time. Then I resigned to take up writing as a career and also at the same time, trading. So that's all about me. And my first book, Mind Under Microscope, was published last year. And it has gotten great recognition from all parts of the world.
Okay. So that's all about me. Okay, so like your book is sold in like which country? Like only in India, or you have been selling your books in most of the country? Like,
yeah. I've published it through Amazon. So okay. I've gotten that wide reach. So basically, what happens is when you publish through Amazon, and if the content is good, people from all over the world are going to read it.
Okay.
So the most of the sales have come from US. Then some from Canada, then Australia, and Europe. Yeah, from all parts of the world. Yeah, obviously from India also.
Okay, fine. So that's quite interesting. Because in abroad country like US, Canada, and all, okay, the people like to read books very much. But if I talk about India, like in India also people read, but very less people are interested in reading the books. Fine. Yeah. So Mr. Abhilash, like today, I will talk, like we will talk on your books, okay, like overview of your book. And like we will little bit discuss summary of your book and overview of your book. So like, can you like tell something about your book? Like what things have you written, or what is the inside content of your book? What do you want to convey from your book?
Okay, sure. So before getting into that, I would say how I gotten into writing this book. Because I have an Instagram page called A Writer for Reason. From there, it all started. So when I started posting quotes, I have a habit of posting quotes there. So when I started posting quotes, people started to relate it. People from all parts of India or from other places started to relate, and they messaged their problems and things like that. And I thought it's not practical to answer to each and every question from them. So from there, I got this idea of writing a book. Why not write a book and get it into the people's.
Like basically what you have done, like you have taken the problem of most of the people and you have
I've tried to assimilate it into a solution and just addressing their problems, because you know the thing is no matter whatever the problem, no problem is unique problem. It all has a particular pattern and everything like that. So you can easily write that and people can relate also.
Okay.
How I came up with the idea of writing a book.
Okay, so like most generally, like which kind of problems have you written on the book? Like the mostly problems you have emphasized on the book.
The name of the book is Mind Under Microscope. So the title itself explains. So I'm just explaining about how I interpret mind, how from my observation, not from theoretical perspectives. More than that, anyone can do that. Observing our mind, recognizing the patterns. And what happens when we analyze ourselves, we are analyzing all the people around the world, because mind is the same for everyone.
Okay. You know,
there can be different interests. People can have different aptitudes and things like that, but they all share a common mind. We all will be happy with something good, and we all will be sad with something bad. So there's an algorithm going on in the mind. From there I got the idea of writing a book about mind, because if I just analyze and observe myself, that's enough to address other people and their problems. That's how I came across writing this book and reaching out and relating and relating to as many people as I can. So the book mainly has 2-3 parts. In the first part, I'm talking about how mind works from a common man's perspective. How mind works. That's the in mind there are many components, and we can have n number of classifications. But the most important is thoughts, emotions. Those are the kind of classifications I have done. And mind in terms of the layers: subconscious mind, conscious mind, and critical mind. So those things are discussed in the first part of the book. And after that, I've discussed about biases in the mind. There are many biases, like negative bias, recency bias, so many biases. Our decisions are always influenced by the biases that we have. So I've discussed that in the next part. And in the third part, though it is not divided into parts, I'm just saying for the sake of understanding. So in the next part, I've discussed about perception. How we see the problem, how to deal with the problem, things like that. Then the book ends with some of my personal accounts with the law of attraction, how it works in the normal world, and how it works, how it is related to patients, things like that. That's all about the summary of the book.
Okay, means like you have not covered a specific topic, okay? Like you have covered a large amount of things you have covered.
Yeah. The book also have very important topics like how to control anger, self-awareness. We can call this book pretty much related to self-awareness.
Self-awareness.
If I can summarize in a word, how to cultivate self-awareness. That's what I've been doing in my lifetime, and also I try to teach other people also.
One question I have in my mind, okay. So how you deal with toxic people, okay? Because in nowadays, scenario, if you see, okay, there is a lot of toxic people are all around us, okay? For example, if you're doing something good or if you're doing something out of box, then definitely you will see that there will be a lot of toxic people, okay, will try to pull you down. A lot of like not good people. So how you handle these kind of things? Like how you handle toxicity?
Yeah, before answering that questions, I would say that toxicity is something that's all in all of us, okay? Because toxicity comes from a place where we crave attention. Toxic people do toxic things because they want attention from people, because they are doing normal things, we are not interested. So they are doing something outrageous so that they can capture our attention. So coming back to the question, how to deal with toxic people, better not to indulge or surround yourself so much with toxic people. If you understand these people are not good, and then try not to argue with them, just stay back. Things like you can do things like that. But if you are in a situation where you are compelled to be in a particular place, then we can take some measures, okay? Like anticipating something. That's a technique, thinking technique. There, if we can anticipate something, okay, he or she may provoke us, we can anticipate and imagine that scenario, then we are not provoked when the actual event happens. That we can do, okay? Also, we can in the initial stages we can politely ignore them, or in the later stages you can be strict with yourself and you can say no.
So very well, okay, and you gave a little bit different answer, okay, that how we can deal, okay, and how especially you deal with toxic people. Okay, fine. And one more question, okay, I have that, because nowadays people, okay, become very angry soon, okay. For example, if they get any toxic people, so they are very angry. Or if anybody comment, okay, for example, I am making YouTube or I am doing something, so if anybody commented wrong comment, or something is happening, so people get very angry soon nowadays, especially in 21st century. So my question is that how we can control anger? Okay, because how we can control? Because a lot of people in anger, they do something wrong or they spoil themselves. So my question is that how we can control anger and how you do that?
You have touched upon a very important question, especially in this century, because you know, we want things to happen in our way. So if I ask you, Rishabh, when you also might get angry, right? At some point, you also might have gotten angry, or in the future also you may get angry. And you know, do you know why you get angry?
Okay, like something which doesn't happen according to me or according to my thinking.
Indeed. Because we always want things to happen in congruence with our thoughts. Okay. So that's the reason why we get angry. If something happens which we don't believe in, if somebody says something which we don't believe in. And also there are some people who find a pleasure in provoking you, making you angry. That's their pleasure lies. So anger, you first have to understand is how I visualize anger is like somebody is, somebody is trying to control you.
Okay.
That's the perspective that I have. That, suppose you are getting angry with me. Means, or you are making me angry. Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. You are talking something toxic and I am getting angry. So in that case, I won't get angry because I know you are provoking me.
Okay.
You are provoking me and I am not supposed to be controlled by someone else.
Mm.
So what I do is I have this thinking that whenever you provoke me, I know you are trying to take control of my mind. And I'm not going to allow anyone to control my mind other than me. I have that instant awareness. So initially, I also used to get angry in all situations. But then I understood it's all because someone is provoking and I'm just acting to their tune.
So the thing is,
you can refrain from that. You can restrict yourself from getting angry by waiting for a few seconds. That I have also addressed this problem in the book.
Okay.
So you have to wait 2 minutes.
Okay.
Before getting angry. In that 2 minutes, you will have that self-awareness that if you have practiced enough, you will have that awareness that somebody else is trying to control you.
Okay, fine.
Then you will refrain. Then your rational mind will interfere and you will settle down.
Okay, fine. Yeah, like you gave a very interesting tip.
Anger is a reptilian brain reaction. That's an animal instinct. Okay.
Okay.
Anger is something that is instant, that's impulsive, that has no rational.
So, like, is there any method to control it? Like, as you said, one thing, okay, that we should. So, is there any more ways to control it? Because I have heard from a lot of people that you should start counting the numbers or something. So, is there any more method, something?
I haven't heard. I've heard of people talking about these abstract methods, like doing this and that. And I don't think it works in the practical world. Okay.
No, like, it is for a short term. Like what we hear, it is for the short term, but your solution is a long-term solution.
My solution, refraining from talking, right? At that time. No, like we are controlling our emotions by not reacting to it immediately. That's what I said.
Yeah.
But I personally think that's a instantaneous solution, but because that worked for me. Because When you try to provoke me, at the same moment, I'm visualizing you as somebody who is trying to take control of me. That image.
Okay, fine.